Ghetto Free Press, and I'm George Master Rhymes.
Psalm number one. It actually is a man that walks not in the concert of the ungodly. Thou standing in the way of sinners, not sitting in the seat of the stone, but his delight in the law of the Lord, and in his law will he meditate day and night. Father, we come now to thank you for this day. Lord, we pray the power of mind down last night, and Lord, we thank you that you watch over all of our lives. And Father, I thank you that you give us another day to understand your voice. Now, Father, as we go to our meeting tonight, touch our heart and our mind. Give us real knowledge and understanding. Give us a heart that it may please you. Help us to be obedient. Help us to do what's right. And you may please you in your sight. Then, Father, as we pass it along the way of life, continue to hold our hand. In Jesus' name, we all say, amen.
Well, that's all right. That's all right. That's all right. Oh, that's all right. Long as I know.
This hearing is a public forum, We do have, along with the president, Brother Graylin Quarterman, who is the assistant secretary, and he is here with him. I believe the treasurer for the state is here, Sister Hudley. God bless you. Amen. And his her husband is also here, the previous district coordinator, Mr. Hudley. And we are, again, we're thankful for you, your presence here. And I'm going to go ahead now and turn it over to Brother Quarterman.
Let me say good evening to you all.
Good evening.
Good evening. I'm here to thank President Theos for the work that he do in this community. And as we stand to just introduce our president for the Georgia State NAACP, one who is have a combining passion for helping people through law, education, and faith. Our president, Dr. Johnson, is called to serve the present age. He is the state president, having been elected in October 2013 as the youngest person to hold the state office. As a committed servant and leader, Dr. Johnson has served as an ordained minister for 18 years. He is the senior minister at the Mount Moriah Missionary Baptist Church in Pembroke, Georgia. And also Magnolia Missionary Baptist Church in Statesboro. Dr. Johnson is in private practice with the Johnson firm, attorney firm in Statesboro, Georgia, and also he practices criminal and civil law in the state and federal courts in Georgia. Dr. Johnson is a Diamond Life member and has worked for the NAACP in a variety of capacities, including the State Legal Redress Director, the State Executive Director, Southeast Regional Director. As Southeast Regional Director, Dr. Johnson was the Chief Manager of the NAACP Public Policy Agenda and administrative activities in Alabama, Florida, Georgia, Mississippi, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Tennessee. Today he is recognized he's a recognized, thorough, and thoughtful leader, having testified before Congress, lecturing across the country, and writing on the concept of race, measuring equality, and understanding of power and public policy. Dr. Johnson is one of the greatest presidents the state of Georgia have seen. At this time, we present to you our president, Dr. Francis Johnson.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I greet you tonight on behalf of freedom fighters across the state, and on behalf of our president and CEO, Cornell William Brooks, who I shared with during my drive down from Statesboro. I talked with him about the serious issues going on in Brunswick. He shared his sincere concerns. Greet you on behalf of Rosalind McAllister Brock, Chairman of the National Board of Directors, and on behalf of the 1,500 adult branches, over 500 youth councils, which are the NAACP around this world. But I must greet you tonight also on behalf of the spirit of our ancestors, who I commune with on my ride down, the spirit of Moses and Harriet and Sojourner in Denmark, Martin, Medgar, and Malcolm. Must greet you in the spirit of those ancestors whose bodies carpet the chilly waters of the Atlantic, not far from this church, coast of Africa to the shores of North America. In the spirit of all of those who on slave ships were stacked one on top of the other, shackled together, hardly anything to eat, no clean water to drink, no bathrooms to use, who were diseased and disheartened, who were beaten and battered.
Yes, sir.
Greet you in the spirit of those who worked in the cotton fields and sugarcane fields and rice plantations around this church from can't see in the morning to can't see at night. I believe I got a church in here tonight. In the spirit of those who endured the hoses and the dogs and the Jim Crow laws and the separate but unequal and the poll taxes and the literacy tests and the crosses burning in their yards. The strange fruit hanging on their trees. There's still strange fruit hanging on our trees today. Trayvon Martin was strange fruit. Eric Gardner, strange fruit. Sandra Bland, strange fruit. Tamir Rice, strange fruit. Anthony Hill, strange fruit. Those who watched bodies float down rivers. Those who endured all of that just so we can be here tonight. I know that we come to this church over a ways that with tears have been watered. We come to this church tonight treading our path through the blood of the slaughter. We come here tonight to testify in the midst of all of that. We serve an awesome God. God who have taken us from chopping cotton to conquering chemistry.
Yes, sir.
A God that has taken us from tying up tobacco. You all don't know about tying up tobacco.
My God.
To tackling industry. And in every walk of life, from janitor to teacher to lawyer to judge to even president of the United States.
Oh, yes, sir.
These are all testimonies of how awesome a God that we truly serve. And so, everywhere I speak, I always tell our story. But there are folks who will tell you not to tell that story. Why do you spend time on that part of our history? Because you must understand that that history is directly connected to what you're dealing with right now.
That's true, sir.
All right.
So we've come to this place tonight to talk. Talk about Constitution of these United States, particularly the Sixth Amendment to the Constitution.
Yes, sir.
The Sixth Amendment to the Constitution guarantees that every person charged with a crime under the United States or under the states that make up this union and their regime of laws would have a right to counsel. That they would fundamentally have a process for the adjudication of those charged crimes that would be fair.
Yes, sir.
That would afford them due process. That would be before a neutral tribunal. That would give them certain other rights and privileges. And we've come tonight to not discuss a black or white issue. We've come tonight to discuss a red, white, and blue issue.
Yes, sir.
This is an American issue.
Yes, sir.
Now I know that there's some crazy politicians seeking to become elected as president who do not believe that America is what she should be.
Yes, sir.
And to that point, we agree. But to the extent that he says he wants to make America great again, oh, don't get quiet on me.
No, no, no.
We're here at the NAACP gathering. You can be free to speak your mind in here.
Yes,
amen.
Yes.
And although we are nonpartisan, we are certainly political. And so I just have this advice that I want to parenthetically insert into this opening before we hear from you. If you're thinking about
Trump, you ought to duck Trump.
My.
You might be feeling the burn, and that's all right, too. You may need to come to understand that the best man for the highest job might be a woman.
My.
America is on her way to greatness. And the work that the NAACP has done over the last 107 years have paved the way to that greatness.
Amen.
But as long as there's a child without enough food to eat to conquer the hunger in their stomach,
all right,
we can't say that we're great.
No, we don't.
As long as there is a person who starves for knowledge, and they have two choices, either indent yourself and become a new slave with loans, because we can afford to bail out banks, but we can't afford to give a college education to our children.
All right.
We cannot consider ourselves great. As long as our children grow up fundamentally understanding that in order to achieve anything that resembles the American dream, they got to leave Brunswick and leave Glenn County to do it, we can't consider ourselves great.
Yes, sir.
As long as we continue to warehouse a full fifth of the world's incarcerated, far disproportionate to our population, our percentage of the world's population, we can't consider ourselves great.
You're right, sir.
As long as we continue to scrap human beings down to hospital beds and shoot poison into their veins as a part of our criminal justice system, knowing how fraught all kinds of biases,
yes, sir,
largely centered on race and class, in the death penalty, we can't consider ourselves great. As long as this state continues to deny 650,000 people Medicaid expansion, something that you've already paid for in your tax dollars, and are willing to let them go to early graves rather than to agree that the Affordable Care Act is a good idea,
yes, sir,
because it helps give insurance to people who don't have it.
Yes, sir.
We can't consider ourselves great.
Sir.
We are here because we believe that America has the potential to be great.
Oh, yes, sir.
We believe that our part in that is the part that every generation has to make this a more perfect union.
Yeah.
America and this state with her problems is still a shining beacon of hope to people around the world. And if the Constitution is important enough that we pray for our young people, our men and women, many of them just up from being boys and girls, and put them on buses and put them on ships not far from this church.
Yes, sir.
To go fight on distant soil. And defend our flag. The Constitution is worth making real right here in Brunswick, Georgia.
Amen.
Right here in this judicial district. And so we're here tonight to talk about the Sixth Amendment. We're here to talk about what we believe every citizen deserves, what we believe certain citizens have not been receiving. First of all, I received a complaint that had 38 specific issues that this branch has found through its investigation in its local legal redress committee. These range from procedural issues that deal with, that really could probably be resolved if the parties who are players within this system would get together and communicate more effectively. Instead of warring at each other through media press releases or hiding behind their offices in silence,
yes, sir,
to sit down at the table of understanding.
Mercy.
Because this is an American issue. This goes to the quality of our democracy. But many of these issues can be resolved if the players involved in this judicial district would step back from their egos.
Amen.
Step back from their positions.
Amen.
And say not is what is best for me getting reelected. What's
What's not best in my interest for me looking like I've not done anything wrong? How to pass the buck, shun accountability, but to say what is in the best interest of all of the citizens of Glenn County.
Yes, sir.
This is a time to be big, not a time to be small. My grandmother said you got to make a choice in your life. You can't be big and small at the same time.
Amen.
This is a time for people to be big. And I pray that the leaders will hear me well, that we invite them to the table of understanding. Come, let us reason together over these 38 issues and see what we can come to agreement about, what we can talk through, and what we can work out. It's amazing to me how people can live in the same town, work in the same judicial system, and not have enough courage to walk across the hall, sit down with their counterpart, and have a conversation.
Amen.
All of these news reports, all of these statements and threats of strikes and terminations could be resolved if people would just simply dialogue with one another.
That's true, sir.
There are also some other issues in these 38 that I have reviewed that deeply trouble me. And they trouble not just the NAACP, but they trouble our partners with the American Civil Liberties Union. They trouble our partners with the Lawyers Committee on the Civil Rights. They trouble our partners with the Southern Center for Human Rights. They trouble our partners at the Advancement Project. And so, if these issues are not resolved, we do our best work at the table of understanding. But if these issues are not resolved at that table of understanding, we reserve the right to use direct action and litigation if necessary.
Amen.
To achieve our ends.
Amen.
Which are nothing more than what many of the partners or the players in this system took an oath to do anyway, which is uphold the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the state of Georgia. And if these allegations are true, and there is evidence that there is a troubling pattern and practice, but if these allegations are fully substantiated, then those players have not been upholding their duty in terms of the Constitution of the United States or the state of Georgia. These are serious issues. This is what I know about the Sixth Amendment, and this is what the NAACP deeply believes, that every citizen charged with a crime here in Glenn County has the right to continuous representation by an attorney. And that attorney preferably should be the same attorney that sits down with them at their initial interview and that carries their case through its adjudication. It is hard to represent someone when they get a different lawyer every time.
Yes,
when they are never guaranteed who's going to show up, if anybody's going to show up at all.
Yes,
continuous representation of a defendant by the same attorney. Secondly, we believe that there is a constitutional imperative that there is independence in the public defender's office. I know that that is a serious concern of many of you, whether termination of the previous public defender was motivated because of his strong action on behalf of the indigent. I'm concerned about that too. We will leave no stone unturned in this investigation. But my primary concern isn't with anybody's job. My concern is with the people who are suffering in a system that is not serving them well.
Amen.
I've talked with Brian Tyson, who has engaged our office and met every one of our requests thus far, that there must be independence. There shouldn't be undue influence from the public defender to not do his job, which is to defend the public.
Yes, sir.
It may not be politic. It may not be polite. And sometimes in doing this work as a lawyer, you've got to be willing to ruffle some folks' feathers.
Yes, sir.
You don't get into this kind of work thinking that you have to have and keep and make friends. Thirdly, we believe that there should be an abolishment of any fees that you have to pay first to meet with a public defender. And we understand that at the municipal level and at the state court level, sometimes there's an application fee that you have to
You have to pay first in order to be represented by the public defender. Well, it begs reason that if you are indigent, you can't pay the fee.
That's true.
Especially when we live in a society that will bail out billionaires and millionaires, but won't raise the minimum wage for poor working Americans. Many in this congregation may be working a minimum wage job, if you can get 40 hours, and work every day of the year, and just pray to God you don't get sick, or your child doesn't have some activity that you need to be there and be a good parent at. You can work every day of the year, not miss a day of work, and still be under the poverty line. That's un-American.
Yes, sir.
So they've abolished any fees for service as a precondition to being able to talk with a lawyer, first and foremost. Fourth, we believe that there's got to be an understanding of the political interference that is present in the defense function. When you have a local appointing council that is made up of people who are in direct competition with the public defender's office, when you have a local appointing council that does not have one single public advocate on it, where you have a local appointing council where there was no way in from anyone on this side of town, on this side of the railroad tracks, you have no persons of color represented on that local appointing council. And we need to understand that there's significant political interference with the defense function of the public defender here locally. You have a lack of diversity within your judicial district. You have a lack of diversity amongst the lawyers. You have a lack of diversity amongst the judges. You have a lack of diversity amongst the court officials. Even down to the secretary pool, you have a lack of diversity. That results in political interference. When citizens come into the courtroom, they see themselves represented in the jail population. But when they come into the courtroom,
yes, sir,
they see that, yes, they see themselves represented in the line to pay their property tax bill. But when they come into the courtroom, they see themselves represented in the line to pay for other goods and services in the community, buying cars and building homes. But when they come into the courtroom, when everybody looks different from them,
yes, sir.
Preach.
That's a political statement.
Yes, sir.
I think back to Tunis Campbell, a name that you don't hear preached from pulpits because we've forgotten his legacy too. I remind the citizens who are here tonight that Tunis Campbell, at one point after the Civil War, before they ran him out of here, was a fighting preacher. You don't have too many of those anymore either. They want your money in the plate, but they won't fight for your babies at the school board.
Preach.
They want you to show up and sing in the choir, but they won't show up to fight for you when it comes down to it. You don't see those Negroes.
There it is.
You told them I'd tell you. You told them I said it because if they were concerned, they would be here tonight.
Yes, sir.
Right again.
And the powers that be count on them not organizing themselves, to be more afraid that they're going to lose favor, that they may be not invited to the next round of golf on the golf course, that maybe they won't be able to slap backs at Ryan's with the people who hold the power in this town. But either you have made a commitment to serve Christ, or you need to quit singing that song, "I'm a servant of the Lord, and I'll serve him until I die."
Yeah.
Our boys are languishing in jail. We so busy buying and selling and hosting pastors' anniversaries, we haven't took the time to go down and visit them in the first place. When Jesus said, "I'll come back and judge you, and I'll ask you some questions. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you put clothes on my back. When I was in peril, you did come to visit me." There's a work in this, not just for the players downtown,
town, those who have positions of authority within the system. But there's a role to be played by faith leaders, pastors, clergymen.
Yes, sir.
People of faith in this community. You should have never let it got this bad in the first place.
Preach. Preach. Preach.
Political interference. Politics is simple. Don't let people try to tell you it's complicated. Politics is who gets what, when, where, and how.
Right. That's right.
And what I'm asking for is for the stakeholders who always have something to say about who's going to get something to not interfere with the public defender system. But if they want to help the public defender system, they can make sure that the public defender system has what it needs to defend the public. That the people who work as public defenders, who've gone to law school, who passed the bar, who are attorneys, just like the people who work in the district attorney's office. They should be paid the same as the people who are prosecuting them.
All right.
They should have available to them the resources necessary to defend the public in cases.
All right.
That's a political question. We give the public defender's office what it needs to represent the indigent in this area. Just two more issues that are important to us, things that we believe are fundamental to a fair system that represents the best of America's ideals. One is we got to understand judicial interference within the defense function. That we need judges who will judge cases. We don't need judges who will advise the and feel as if they are an extension of the district attorney's office.
All right now.
Or if they're an extension of the executive branch of government. They are not an extension of the executive branch of government. Our judiciary, as organized in Article 3 of the Constitution of the United States, should be independent. And if there's not true independence, then that failure to observe those basic lanes, stay in your lane, will result in interference in the defense function.
Yes, sir.
And then the last thing that we have come to ensure, and this is not the end, this is just the beginning, that there is some systemic accountability, that an indigent defense system effectiveness should be judged on whether you can measure the quality of service provided to its clients. And I think if you would survey, and this is from what we've gathered thus far, and I want to hear more tonight. If you would survey those who are served by the system, that's got to be one measure of how well you're doing.
Amen.
Everybody needs a job evaluation from time to time.
Amen.
The folks who are served by the system, they would say to you that it is a second-class system. That if you are wealthy, or you have access to money, there's one system of justice for you here in Glenn County in Brunswick. And if you're poor, then you are relegated to a second-class system. There may be well-intentioned lawyers working, but it is a second-class system that is overworked, undermanned, understaffed, and doesn't have the resources to do what it needs to do. And that results in a second-class system.
It's true. It's true.
There's got to be accountability for that.
Amen.
That indigent defendants need to receive a level of advocacy that is consistent with our constitutional demands. These services are not being provided now, but they must be provided if we are going to have the audacity in front of the Glenn County Courthouse to fly the flag of these United States. That flag should have meaning. More than just a symbol you tote out patriotic events. It has meaning. It has meaning because it has been made sacred by the blood, the sweat, and the tears of so many Americans. This is not a black problem. This is a poor people's problem.
Amen.
Because poor white people are suffering as well.
Amen.
Poor Latino people are suffering as well.
All right.
Poor women and children are suffering as well.
and we must do something to address it. As I conclude my remarks tonight, and really prepare to listen to what you have to present, I think about our ancestors. I can't be this close to the Atlantic Ocean. It's beautiful down here. But as I marvel at the beauty of the water down here, I have to come to the sober reality that that water is also a graveyard. And as I drove by, I don't mind telling you that I realized, as Paul realized, that there's a great cloud of witnesses.
Yes, sir.
And they gathered around this church tonight. I wonder if this is just going to be one meeting and they're going to go back to doing what they were doing. There's a great cloud of witnesses gathered tonight. I wonder if it means losing relationships, would they go that far? I wonder if it means that some of your members, Pastor, may not support you in this. And you'll find that you thought you had friends, but you don't have friends when you get out there on the limb. Will they go that far? If it means that their reputation may be lost, will they go that far? If it means that they get threats, bodily harm, will they go that far? And then I think back to those ships as they sat in the docks in Africa, loaded down with the cargo that I talked about, the human cargo. I imagine that as long as those persons were in the dock and they could look out the ship and still see the land and trees and beaches and their home, that they knew that their hope remained in them. But I am aware that those boats began to move.
Yes, sir.
And brother, there came a point in time when they could see no land anymore. I wonder if they could look up and see the sky, or maybe at night see the stars and remember a familiar pattern. Maybe if they saw something familiar in the sky, that their hope remained. My study of the Middle Passage tells me that it got to a point that they were so far from land and so far from sky that they knew and that was familiar to them, that they got so far into that journey from freedom to slavery, they did not know where they were. They did not know where they were going. But they knew who they were. My question to you tonight is, do you know who you are? Because if you knew who you were, even if it did not matter to you personally, if you believe you could afford an attorney if you were charged with a crime or your child was charged with a crime, it should still matter to you.
Yes, amen.
Oh, freedom.
Yes, sir.
Oh, freedom over me. For I'll be a slave.
Yes, sir.
I'll be buried in my grave. Go home to be with the Lord and be free. Only those who know who they are can say that. People who don't know who they are will say things like this to you: well, they shouldn't have got in trouble in the first place.
All right. Tell them.
They don't bother me because I don't get in no trouble. It don't make no difference to me what they do. If I was you, I wouldn't bother that. Leave that alone, Pastor.
Look out there now.
People who don't know who they are would tell you, that's why I don't join the NWSB right now, because I got to live here.
Hey,
like this is living.
Have mercy.
They'll try to blame other things. Well, what kids need to do is have better parents. Well, that might be true. But that's not what we're talking about tonight.
All right.
And if we call a meeting to talk about better parenting, the people who say that the kids need better parents wouldn't show up anyway.
Wouldn't show up.
So don't let people who don't know who they are try to tell you who you should be.
Hammer! Go ahead now.
You are the NAACP.
the most feared and revered, the most cursed and discussed. People may not like us, but they wouldn't be where they are without us. People who won't never fail to never listen to thank you, are working a job, holding a position, have a degree that they've earned, all because the NAACP fought for them.
Yes, sir.
So when it's time to fight for others, we can do no less. It is my prayer that we would engage tonight in the spirit of seeking to find what we can do to make life better for the least here in Brunswick and Glynn County. But it's not how you are served in life that truly will determine the value of your life. King said it best as I close this part. If I can help somebody else as I pass along, then my living and then the living of the ancestors who came before you would not have been in vain. Amen. Why don't you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? And there are a few, for those who are here, and if you're here from the media, there are a few handouts that address those 38 specific issues that the NAACP believes are problems within the system. And I've had those, and we are reviewing those, and we will have a report on them soon. But it was important for me to come to hear myself from the people in this community what you have dealt with. There is a microphone. I am here, and I'm not leaving until I hear what people have to say. So if you have been impacted by this system, we've come to receive your testimony tonight. We've come to hear from the people who've been impacted directly, and we'd ask that you would line up at this time.
First, Mr. President, we thank you for coming to a place that has been destroyed. And the evidence has been around us for a long time. We thank you for being here. You and I have had several conversations about this process. And one of them had to do with the notion of protocol. I'm a fierce freedom fighter. I don't make no apologies to no one in this city, in this state.
Just talk to me, brother.
Can I come up where you are then so I can talk to you?
Well, you have an opportunity to talk to me often. We've talked 4 or 5 times.
Well, I don't make any apologies.
But what I really want to hear how you have been impacted, and how others have been impacted about the system. I don't want to deal with branch business. That's a distraction to what we should be doing here, which is the indigent defense system. Let's move on to that.
And I don't mind not dealing with branch business.